Come on, bless the Lord with me today. Come on, let's go bless the Lord. Thank you, Elder, for the reading of the scripture. Amen. Join me, if you will, back in the scripture that's read for you today in the book of St. John's in the 10th chapter, verse number 14 and 15, Elder read for us. But if I could, have you just drop down a little bit as we just round out our thought here for today. I want to, in conjunction with verse 14 and 15, read verses 25 through 27. Verses 25 through 27, you don't have to stand again, but when you have it, let me hear you say amen.
Amen.
And the Bible reads as follows. Jesus answered them, I told you, and ye believed not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me.
Wow.
But ye believe not, because you are not of my sheep.
Yes.
Turn to somebody and say, there it is.
There it is.
As I said unto you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me.
Wow.
May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of this anointed word. And may I today have the courage, amen, to preach and let the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Amen. If you would, but for a few moments, if you will pray with me and pray for me, I want to use as a preaching thought for your consideration, he knows me by name.
Amen.
Amen. He knows me by name. Turn to somebody and tell him he knows my name.
He knows my name.
Amen. Come on, curse somebody. Tell him he knows my name.
He knows my name.
Amen. He knows my name. What is important in a name? What is important about a name? Why is a name important to us and for us? Turn to somebody and ask them, why is a name important?
Why is a name important?
We have three children, Monique and Matthew and Mark. And let me speak to the latter because God was, and certainly my wife and I, were very intentional in the naming of our children. First was Matthew and the male children, and then obviously Mark followed him. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And so we were very intentional in naming our children, in particular our sons. What does their names mean? What does the name Lawrence or Audrey mean? Turn to somebody and ask, what does your name mean?
What does your name mean?
In North America, the North American culture, we find ourselves naming children with names that appeal to our ears. I'm going someplace. We sound them out. And we try out the rhythm so that they fit what we want to name our children. Sometimes we name our children after a family relative to honor them, and then yet sometimes we reject the names that are given to us because of something that we just have not let go of. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Turn to somebody and ask them, what's in the name?
What's in the name?
The name Matthew. Amen. Stay close to home. The name Matthew. And by the way, I'm grateful to have our son Matthew.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. The name Matthew, amen, means gift of the Lord. The name Mark means warlike, consecrated to God for warfare. The name Audrey, I looked it up. One who is noble and of strength. And then finally, the name Lawrence. And I thank God for the name that my parents gave me Sometimes we all can, and I'll make it personal, sometimes we can take so casual what has been given to us. And I'm learning, and especially through this study, that names are important. The name Lawrence means victorious. As we go through life, many different people call our name. And it's amazing to me just how many different messages, and I want you to listen to this part carefully because it's going to take you back. It's amazing how many different messages can be conveyed to us depending on how someone calls our name. Growing up when my mother, and I'll just stay with my mom, growing up when my mom would call me or call one of my siblings, amen, there was a very distinctive message that was, am I talking to anybody?
Yeah.
Anybody remember back, Brother Anthony Medea called, and when she would call your name, it would communicate something that she didn't have to say with words.
That's right.
Somebody talk back to me.
That's right.
It was one thing, actually, for your mother or for my mother to call my name. It would be another thing for my mother to call each one of my name. I want somebody to talk back to me.
Yeah.
Now, I don't have the middle name, but amen, when I heard her say Lawrence White, I want somebody to talk back to me. Amen. There was something in her calling my whole name. And I knew that she was saying something or preparing me. Turn to somebody and say, she was preparing. Something she was preparing me for when she called my full name, or when she would call one of my brothers and use their middle names, or my sister, Anita Diane White. And when she called that name, the first thing I said is, I said, she get ready to get up. Hit my brother, sneeze. I hear my brother get ready to go down. I don't know what she did, but get ready to go down. And you know, and it's crazy. Watch, it's crazy how when we were kids, we joy in knowing that somebody's getting ready to get it. Give me about 10 hands. Let's just be real, that we joy, remember, we get happy, we start celebrating. You know, because, you know, I came from a family of 10 kids, 5 boys, 5 girls, and we did each other wrong like it was a daily activity. I don't know about anybody else, and so I was happy the occasion when I knew that my brother was getting ready to get it. I said, Dad, that's what you get. I was a baby, I couldn't walk none, can I just pause for, I'm going to go on reminisce a little bit. I couldn't walk none of them because I was the youngest, but, you know, I get happy, Sister Penny, when my brother would get in trouble, and I say, yeah, I couldn't whoop you, but watch what Dad did me do. It just, anybody remember that joy? Right there, turn to somebody and tell them there's something in the name. Amen. I kind of digress a little bit. Amen. As we go through life again, many messages can be conveyed by how somebody will call your name. Sometimes it is done very calm, gently, loving. But other times, especially when, again, they use their whole name, it conveys a completely different message. Or in the classroom, maybe somebody remember this, in the classroom, the teacher would call your name. And sometimes you were glad when she called your name, and then how many of us knew that there were other times where you were not glad when she was calling in your name? Maybe you were passing a note in class, or you were talking. How many talkers I got in the house that were talking in class, and you talked too much, and then the teacher had to call your name, and then if you were like me, a few minutes after, she say, and I'm going to call Miss White. Okay. How many of us know that was the worst thing in the world for her to say that she was going to call your mother? Amen. Turn to somebody and tell them, but I'm glad Jesus knows my name. Very quickly, we're going to close. This morning I want to celebrate with someone when the Lord called your name. I want to take a moment with someone and walk down memories lane, or take a time to look back over your life and to reflect and to celebrate with you that the Lord called your name. How many are glad that the Lord called your name?
Yes, yes.
As I considered the text and as I looked back through the Word of God, I found that there were many, and I'm just going to touch four examples today. Amen. Certainly cannot be exhausted because the Word of God is too complete. But I want to consider four names in the Word of God. Four names, Sister Jennifer, that God called. Amen. If we go back to the book of beginnings, we find that the Lord called Adam.
Right.
And I want to talk to somebody today who the Lord called you when you were in sin.
Yes.
I'm going to talk to somebody today who can reflect and relate to God calling Adam's name when you were struggling with the shame and the guilt of your life choice. Because see, in the context of the book of the beginnings, in the text in Genesis, when God called Adam's name and Adam was hiding from God. And how many of us have ever played a game of hide and seek with God? But the Lord has a way, and when I reflected, when I went back and looked at in the book of Genesis and looked at the interaction, the dialogue between God and Adam, that which he had created, it made me excited that even in my sin, God still knew my name. Then when we look back, I want to encourage somebody, because somebody here today, you might be struggling with somebody and you might think that God has forgotten about you, or you may be struggling with in an area of your life and you may feel like that disqualifies you. But I want you to be assured that in spite of what you're doing, what you're going through, he still knows your name.
Yeah.
And in spite of what you're challenged with today, in spite of what may be weighing upon you today, you need to know that God is still calling for you. See, many times the enemy will try to convince us and tell us that because there's an area of my life that God is working on, there's an area of my life that needs to be improved, there's an area of my life that I'm struggling and I'm trying to get better in, Sister Terry, the enemy will try and tell me that the Lord has forgotten my name. But I'm here to tell somebody today that just like Adam, that in spite of your life choices, in spite of sin showing up in your life, God is still calling you. Turn to somebody and tell them God is calling you.
God is calling you.
Secondly, as I rush through this short sharing moment, I want to reflect on the name Moses. So God not only called Adam, but he called Moses. And when he called Moses, Moses was called up to the mountain. How many of us remember when Moses was called up to the mountain?
Yeah.
And it said that he saw the burning bush that was not being consumed. And that God began to speak to him and give him his assignment. But how many of us recognize that when God called Moses, that Moses was actually living a double life? Somebody talk back to me. How many of us here, amen, has been caught in between? You're serving two masters. You know God, but you're making other choices. You love God, but you're doing other things. How many of us, amen, have caught ourselves or found ourselves, mother, in between two opinions? And so it was with Moses. Moses was Pharaoh's son, but Moses was confused. Something was happening on the inside. There was something conflicting. Even when he met those who, amen, reminded him of who he really was. Sometimes God will send people in your life, because God may not call you to you directly, but sometimes God will send people into your life to remind you of who you really are. And so it was with Moses, and Moses was confused. He had an identity crisis, I believe, that one person talked about. Sometimes we have an identity crisis. We're struggling with who we are, but we're confused about who God says we are to be. But thank you, God, that you're able to call to us even in the midst of our confusion. Even when we're chasing after the wrong purpose, God said, I still was calling you. Even when you were serving a taskmaster, and how many of us know sin is a taskmaster? Even when you were serving a taskmaster, I want to encourage somebody not to forget that God was still calling you. Somebody shout, God is still calling me. And And so just like Adam, Moses heard the voice of God calling him to a higher place. And here's where it really got good for me. That Deacon LeGrand, even in the midst of an identity crisis, when God calls me, he always calls me to a higher place.
Amen.
Did anybody get that?
Yeah.
When God calls you, watch this. When God calls you, be assured, beloved, that he's always calling you to a higher place, to a higher purpose, to a higher calling in him. That God never calls you and leaves you right where you are. You can never have an interaction with God and God leaves you where you are. I want to talk to somebody today who is really grateful that you can hear God calling your name.
Amen.
Number three, I only got four. We're going to be done, believe it or not. Number four, watch this. Number three, the third person that I thought about and that I was led to look at, I was led to look at Zacchaeus. I was led to look at Zacchaeus. What do you do when you feel small and you have much but still feel insignificant? The Bible said that Zacchaeus was small in stature. Now he had much riches.
Well,
but he felt insignificant, and he felt challenged because he was small in stature.
My Lord.
And how many of us are warring within ourselves that we have but we feel insignificant? And we have, but we feel small in stature. Sometimes, watch this, because Zacchaeus was looking at the press before him. And we were kind of touching on it this morning, that many times we can look at other people and we can compare ourselves to other people and we can see ourselves not as statuous as they are. And so God sent me here today to tell you that no matter how you see yourself, that he sees you very different.
Amen.
He was rich in stuff, but poor in esteem and spirit. And I've seen a lot of people who have stuff and are still insecure. I've seen a lot of people who have stuff, have money, have cars, have houses, have stuff, and they still have an identity complex. And one of the things that I know about God is that God is able to reach us no matter where we are.
That's right.
In the text it said that Zacchaeus climbed up a sycamore tree. And what's this? The Lord passing by saw him and cried out to him and said, Zacchaeus, come down. Now, isn't it amazing how God can call us in our high place? Because sometimes our stuff will make us put ourselves in a high place.
That's right. Yes, yes, yes.
All right.
I want you to listen to this. Our stuff, turn to somebody and say, your stuff. Sometimes our stuff can put us in a high place. And so the Lord called out, watch it. God has a way. Turn to somebody and say, God has a way. God has a way of calling us out of our self-imposed place, a statue, and say, you need to come down to where I am. And so the next thing that I saw, watch this, the next thing that I saw is that God many times, sometimes will call us, and he has to call us down from a place where we put ourselves, or he has to call us down from a place where our stuff put us superficially and say, you need to come down.
Yeah.
Turn to somebody and tell them God is calling you.
God is calling.
I'm almost done. Watch this. The Bible declares these words. It says that we ought not think of ourselves more highly than we ought to.
Amen.
So I want to talk to somebody who your stuff has got you feeling pretty good. I want to just, because I'm almost done. I only got one more punch, but I want to take a moment just because sometimes our stuff will make us feel secure. Our stuff will make us feel strong. Our stuff will make us feel valuable. Our stuff will start to define our self-worth. But I'm here to tear down down the security of your stuff. I'm here to come against the power or the authority that you think your stuff gives you to let you know that outside of Jesus, you are nothing.
That's it. Wow.
See, Jesus is calling to somebody, calling to us to come out of our stuff. And I'm not necessarily talking about an abundance of stuff. It doesn't even have to be an abundance of stuff. Yes, Zacchaeus was a rich man, but it doesn't even have to be an abundance of stuff. It can just be something that puffs us up to make us think that we're more secure or powerful than we really are.
Right. Right.
Turn to somebody and tell them, Jesus is calling you.
Jesus is calling you.
Lastly. I was led and reflected, and I think one of the reasons, because I kind of have a bias to this story, a bias to this character, if you would, in the Bible. But I was led back to Lazarus. So I want to talk to somebody who, amen, folks gave you away for being dead. Talk to somebody. Anybody ever gave up on you? Anybody ever looked at your situation and drew a conclusion before God spoke?
Come on. Come on.
Anybody ever looked at your circumstance and they tried to write your ending for you? We know the story. Him whom thou lovest is sick. The sickness is not unto death. Lazarus is dead. Show me where you laid him. But then came the call of Jesus. Ain't it good to know that God can call you from the dead? Isn't it good, and I'm done, believe it or not, isn't it good to know that God can call you from a place that most people would define as irreversible? Or maybe I'm talking to somebody who you were stinking. And I'm talking about, because sin stinks. Sin has a stench about it. I want to talk to somebody today who, when you walk in the room, the stench of sin hits the nostrils of those who are saved.
Come on.
I want somebody to talk to me. When you walk in the room, the stench of your sin, the stench of where you're at, your circumstance, your truth, the stench will hit the nostril of those who know the Lord. And they want to give you up and say it's hopeless. But I want to encourage you today that the Lord is calling you. Or maybe you need to look back and remember when you were sinking in sin. And maybe, like I said from the very beginning, this is not calling you to a today truth, but now this is a time to reflect back and celebrate. I'm going to talk to 10 people who can celebrate where God brought you from. See, the word of God is not always to expose or to cover some current truth. Sometimes we need the word to celebrate, to look reflectively up to where God has brought us from. So how do I have somebody in here who can remember when they were in the condition of Lazarus, where they were dead to sin, but God called your name? Here's where you have to make it personal. You have to put your own name in here, because the name is not Lazarus, it's your name. How many in here today can remember, can reflect on when you heard your name? You gave yourself up for dead. Folks around you gave yourself up for dead. Looked at your circumstances, said that it was hopeless, but you heard a still small voice. Somebody tell him, I'm glad he knows my name.
I'm glad he knows my name.
Thank God he knows my name.
Yes.
Thank God he knew my name, mother. Thank God that he didn't forget about me when I forgot about him. When I gave myself up for hopeless, somebody here gave yourself up for hopeless, thought it would never change, that it was always going to be the same, that your ending had already been wrote, but God called your name.
Yes.
Who is that today? Two last scriptures. When I thought about this elder, I thought about the fact that the Lord knows my name. He said, my sheep will hear my voice. He said, I know them by name. See, that's the significance of what I want you to walk out of here today, is that God knows each of us by name, knows each of you by name. And the wonderful thing about God's love, and we've talked about it in our context of being able to love one another, but today I want to leave you with the context of Jesus' love. The wonderful thing about the Lord is that the Lord can know everything there is about you and still choose to love you.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah.
The wonderful thing about the love of Jesus is that the Lord right now, I said, the Lord knows everything there is about him. There's things that your mama don't even know. There's things that your family members don't even know. But the Lord sent me here to encourage you to say, Ashley, even though they don't know, I know, and I still choose to love you.
That's right.
I know everything there is about you, and I'm still calling you because I want you.
Thank you.
I still desire you. Somebody needs to be encouraged that in spite of what it looks like, God is still calling.
Yes. Still calling.
Yes. Yes.
Still calling your name.
Yes.
Well. Last two scriptures. I thought about him knowing my name. And then I reflected on what Jesus said. Last two scriptures. He said, I came that none be lost.
Yes.
But then all come to repentance. Turn to somebody and tell them that included you. And then lastly, I thought about this, because you can never consider the word of God without looking to Calvary. See, when Jesus was calling my name, he wasn't just calling the name Lawrence White. When the Lord was calling your name, he didn't just call Audrey or John. He didn't just call John or Demetri. He didn't just call your name specifically. See, thanks be to God that I was included in all of it.
Amen.
So when he said, I came that none be lost, how many of us know that you included in the none?
Absolutely.
See, the word of God, beloved, the word of God is inclusive. It's not excluded. It's inclusive. And he said, I came that none, somebody shout none.
None.
Somebody shout none. He said, none be lost. And we have to celebrate that we're in the none.
Amen.
But then hanging on the cross.
That's it.
Then hanging on the cross, lastly. Mother Harriet, I heard these words, and I heard them when I was studying last night like I never heard them before. When he said, Father, forgive them.
Wow. That's it.
How many of us, I've started reflecting on the fact, Audrey, that I'm in the them. And I started reflecting, and I started rejoicing. I got happy, Brother Anthony, that I'm them.
Yeah.
You already hear me today. That I was included when he said them. See, he paid for my sins that I committed. He's already put up in storage the sins that I will commit. And thanks be to God, turn to somebody and point at him and say, I'm there. Come on, point at him and say, I'm there. I'm there. When he was talking to John when he was exiled on Patmos, and John asked the question, he saw 144,000. And how many of us know you ain't got to be in the first wave, you just got to make it. Thank God for another number, because we're in that another number. not the number. That no man can number. And I got news. You in that number.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Glory. Thank you, Jesus.
You are in that number.
Amen.
You got to make it personal. Glory, you got to be able to say, I'm in that number. Joan, you got to be able to say, I'm in that number. Adrian, you got to be able to say, I'm in that number. In spite of what I'm going through, you have to decree and declare, Maurice, I'm in that number.
Yeah.
I need about 20 people to point to yourself and decree, I'm in that number.
I'm in that number.
That God, that when Jesus walked up that hill called Calvary, and when they nailed him to the cross, that I was in that number.
Yeah.
That when he said, Father, forgive them for they know not what they do, point to yourself and say, I was in that number. When he said, knows my name.
Yeah.
So today is a day of celebration. This is not a day where, because again, God deals with us on a daily basis. And thanks be to God. Watch this. Thanks be to God. Mother, sometimes God just wants me to celebrate.
That's it.
God wants me to just celebrate and not celebrate in my security, but just celebrate the fact that I'm secure in Christ Jesus. Esther, God wants you to just simply be thankful today that he still knows your name.
Yes, sir.
That in spite of it, I would. Yes, we're all works in progress. Yes, we all have areas where God is working on us. But you have to be able to stand up boldly and say, but he still knows
my name.
He still knows my name. Come on, Kim, let's go. I've ever said before.